sacrifice. Your word says, live and not die. Oh Lord, speak into my life.
Praise God. You may be seated. I want to thank God for the opportunity to speak before you, and also thank Pastor Ngozi and Pastor Inyi for the opportunity to share God's word with you. Now, 2 Timothy 2 verse 2, it says, that which we have heard and learnt, it says, we've committed them to young men. And somebody, like 2 weeks ago, was talking to me about, okay, so two people were outside, and they said they heard me shouting. And the person outside said, I'm sure it's because of money, Pastor Chike is shouting. And I laughed. I said, okay, maybe you know me very well. But what I begin to understand with God is that the places where we have overcome, God expects us to hand them down to people. The body of Christ is suffering from an attack from Satan, and the attack is kingdom financing. And he has come by way of, you know, when people talk about tithes, seeds and all that, it's stemming from somewhere. Some people have sort of bastardized giving, and they've used it to manipulate people. But that does not mean that the principle of sowing and reaping is gone from God's kingdom. It is a basic principle of God. So when we speak and when we say things to people, our hope is that what some people have been able to go through, people are able to also get that and also run with it. The Greek word for testimony, when you read it literally, means that when somebody speaks about their testimony, and that is why we have testimony, is so that it will happen again. So when somebody comes up here and is speaking, the reason that we have a doctrine like testimony is so that when people hear it, they have that belief in their spirit so that it will happen again. Is a spiritual thing that somebody speaks about something, somebody takes hold of it and runs with it. So I tell people sometimes, right? And you see, when Satan fights us, he fights us from a place of understanding and a place of knowledge. You see, as Christians, we keep ourselves pure. You don't fornicate, you don't steal, you don't do those things. But the things that allow us to rise in this kingdom are the things that Satan tampers with. And I'll be honest with you. Not now, but if sometime in the past in my life, if people are giving testimonies, envy will come up. I'll be like, how come this happens to this person and it's not happening to me? And over time, through the Spirit of God, I learned that when things are happening within a specific environment, is a testament to the fact that there's a possibility of that thing happening to you. Do you understand what I'm saying? Is a possibility of... So, you know what I started doing in my spirit? I started doing deliberately. I rejoice with people when they have testimonies. I will dance, I will sing, I will shout. And over the years, it helped me not to be envious. truly, I started becoming happy for people. And I found out that that happiness translated into my own miracles. And see, you know, sometimes when you come up here, there's that tendency for you to say things that don't happen. I used to be envious. If somebody comes up and gives a testimony, I'll be like, why is that not me? When people are clapping, I'll be like, that should be me. But I changed that. I started rejoicing with people. Initially, it was mechanical, right? I was just pushing myself. But over time, it became a tradition. So somebody gave birth, I will rejoice. Somebody got a new job, I will shout, I will rejoice. Somebody got a new car, I will shout, I will rejoice. Somebody got a healing, I will shout and I will rejoice. And you see, the principles of God are simple. When the Bible says, rejoice with them that rejoice, cry with those who cry, it's a simple principle that you must follow to enjoy those things. But guess what happens? When people are up here, Satan tunes people's minds off. And is the very thing that you are asking God for. And the very thing that God wanted to give you, you tuned yourself out of it. See, Christianity can be the most difficult thing and it can be the simplest of things. If we choose to follow the principles of God as they are, the Bible simply says what? Rejoice with them that rejoice. Right? There's a reason. There's a reason. Sometimes offense can take you out of your miracle. You know, sometimes the Bible says, not sometimes, the Bible says in Psalm 40, it says that he did not require sacrifices. Obedience is what God requires. Sometimes prayer is sacrifice. Do you know? Because rather than an act of obedience, to rejoice with somebody, or to respect somebody, or not to take offense from somebody, we would rather come here and we'll be praying 6 hours of prayer. I'm not saying prayer is not good. The Bible says pray without ceasing. But what God wanted to do would not have come from that 6 hours of prayer. It will come from obedience. And God will test you in the things that Satan knows are your weakness. God will tell you, apologize to your daughter. It's a difficult thing to do if you're a parent. That you've done something wrong. You are the dad, you are this. And the Holy Spirit says, apologize. You are rude to your wife in front of your girls. The Holy Spirit will tell you, apologize to your wife in front of the girls. Apologize to the girls for being rude to their mother. It's obedience. The Bible says, treat your wife as equal, so that your prayers will not be hindered. And the Holy Spirit now tells you to apologize, so that you are sowing a seed for your girls to understand that this is the way a man should treat you. But out of pride, you. And they now grow up in that way and look for people who will be rude to them when that is not what God has planned. Then you come up and you are praying and you think God will hear you. It's in the scripture. It says, if you do not treat your wife as equal, your prayers will be hindered. So I just wanted to share that with you. That when people are here and saying some things, because it got me thinking. I was like, I hope I'm not trying to. But when God started showing me some things, as in how I went through struggles. I'll share with somebody this morning, and I know I've shared it before a long time. Now, you want to eat something, you can't eat something. There were some times we couldn't eat food in my house. I would joke and laugh with some people. And I tell them there was a time that we had not eaten meat for days. And we found fish head inside the fridge. And that was what we boiled and fried, and that's what we ate. So when people come out to give their testimonies, it's to shame Satan, not to brag. There are so many things God does for me that I don't say. But the ones that you permit me to say, I say so that people can run with it. That is the power of testimony. So I don't know why this was what I wanted to start with. Whenever people come up here, position your heart. Position your heart is a principle to rejoice with them. Somebody gives birth, rejoice. Somebody gets married, rejoice. Somebody gives a testimony of a job that they got or a scholarship that they got, rejoice. Do not use your mouth. Do not use your feelings to take away what God wants to do for you. Please and please. I don't know who needs to hear this, but that was what just came to my spirit just now. That we must, as a way of principle, rejoice with people who rejoice. You know, the day I was saying, oh, someone got a car, and I was dancing, and I was jumping around. I told somebody, I said some things, maybe people who didn't hear. I said, if you can, even if you don't have a car, you can go and buy car mats for the person as a way of rejoicing. It's a seed that you sown. And I can tell you that over the years, when God starts blessing you, you will point to certain things that God instructed you to do that brought you to that place. Prayer is good, but obedience is better. Praise God. So I'm going to be talking about what I call the testimony of Jesus. The testimony of Jesus. In Revelations 19, verse 10, John, after an angel came to say something, please, let's just put it up. So, he bowed down or lay down on the floor or something, and the angel was saying that there's no need to do this and all that. And towards the end of it, he now said, okay, he said, and I fell at his feet to worship him. And he said unto me, see thou do it not. I am thy fellow servant. And he says, and of thy brethren that have the testimony of Jesus. He says, I am thy fellow servant. And he says, I am and of thy brethren that have the testimony of Jesus. And he now says, worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. He says, I am thy fellow servant. When somebody says, I'm your fellow, it means you people are on the same rank. We are together in all this. And he says, and of thy brethren, your brothers. He says, them of thy brethren that have the testimony of Jesus. And he now says, the spirit, it now says the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. I want us to go now to John 5:19. I'll read some scriptures and then we'll just take it from there and then just try to close up. John 5, verse 19. So he says, so Jesus answered them by saying, I assure you most solemnly, I tell you. Let's read with KJV. I'll tell you when to flip to Amplified. He says, then answered Jesus and said unto them, very, verily I say unto thee, the Son can do nothing of himself, but what he seeth the Father do. For what things soever he doeth, these also doeth the Son likewise. Verse 20. It says, for the Father loveth the Son and showeth him all things that himself doeth, and he will show him greater works than these, that you may marvel. Jesus was talking about what God was showing him. And he said, these ones that you had seen, that you think, he says, he will even show him, that's the Son, greater things. Verse 21. He says, for as the Father raiseth up the dead and quickeneth them, even so the Son quickeneth whom he will. Verse 22. He says, for the Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment unto the Son. Verse 23. He says that all men should honor the Son, even as they honor the Father. He that honoreth not the Son, honoreth not the Father which hath sent him. Verse 24. Let's just be fast. He said, very verily I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me had everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. Verse 25. He says, verily, verily I say unto you, the hour is coming and now is. He says, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall live. Go back to verse 24. I want to just point out something. And here it says, very, very, I say unto you, what does it say? It says, he that what? He that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me. It says, hath everlasting life. Verse 25. He says, the hour is coming and now is. He says, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall what? Live. Now, go to verse 27. I want to just show you something. He says, okay, no, verse 26. He says, for as the Father had life in himself, so had he given to the Son to have life in himself. Verse 27. It says, and had given him authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of Man. Verse 28. It says, marvel not at this. It says, for the hour is coming, in the which all that are in the grave shall hear his voice. Go to verse 29. And it says, and shall comfort they that have done good unto the resurrection of life. So you see, it was differentiating in verse 25 and verse 28. It was differentiating between those who are in the grave and those who are dead. Those who are dead, where do they put them? In the grave. Please, I'm teaching, so please, let's just be alive. Those who are dead, they put them in the grave, right? But here, it's distinguishing between those who are in the grave and those who are dead. And he says, those who hear the words of God shall have everlasting life. He says in verse 25, he says, the hour has come and now is, that those who hear the word of the Son of God that are dead, they shall come to what? Good. Verse 30. Let's go to verse 30 quickly. It says, I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just. It says, because I seek not my own will, but the will of the Father which hath sent me. Verse 31. It says, if I bear witness of myself, my witness is not true. Did you hear that? Jesus Christ is the one speaking here. Verse 32. It says, there is another that beareth witness of me, and I know that the witness which he witnessed of me is true. This is Jesus saying. Jesus is saying that if he bears witness, in other translations, he says, if I give a testimony of myself, he says that testimony is not true. Did you see that in verse 5? Jesus Christ is the one saying, if I give you a testimony of myself, it is not true. But this is Jesus, the Son of God, speaking, right? Good. Let's go to John chapter 8 and from verse 12 quickly. I just want us to quickly go through this scripture, and then we will just take it from there and land. It says, then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. Verse 13. It says, the Pharisees there said unto him, thou bearest record of thyself. Thy record is not true. Did you hear what they said here? So he's giving a testimony of himself when he says he's the light of the world. Well, right? Verse 14. It says, Jesus answered unto them, though I bear record of myself, yet my record is what? Can you see that this is opposite from what Jesus said in chapter 5? He says, for I know whence I came and whither I go. But he says, but you cannot tell whence I come and whither I go. Verse 15. He says, you judge after the flesh. He said, I judge no man. Verse 16. He says, and yet if I judge, he says, my judgment is true. Can you see the other part? He says, if I judge, my judgment is not true. And he ended it there. But look at it. He says, he now, that colon is there. And he now says, for I am not alone. That is the distinguishing factor between John 5 and John 8. Because there, he just said, if I bear. He said, there's another one that bears witness. And he says, whatever that person says is true. Now, he's saying, for I am not alone. But he says, but I and the Father that sent me. In other scriptures, you say, but I am standing with God. So you have two testimonies of Jesus. The first one, he said, if I give you a testimony of myself, he says, it's not true. He says, but there is one who speaketh of me, and what he says is true. But now, Jesus is saying that what I'm saying, this testimony I'm giving you to you, is true. He says, because I'm not saying it alone. I am saying it with the Father, the one who sent me. Go to verse 17. It says, it is also written in your law that the testimony of two men is true. Verse 18. It now says, I am one that bear witness of myself, and the Father that sent me beareth witness of me. In other words, you say, we are two. I am one, and the Father is the second. Now, what I want us to understand here is, there are two scenarios here, and Jesus, the man Christ, was telling them, he said, if I'm talking to you now and I give you this testimony, he says, this testimony is not valid. But if you read from chapter 1 down to 5, and between 5 to 8, Jesus was doing miracles. Feeding 5,000. Jesus was doing miracles. But Jesus came and said, I cannot give a testimony of myself in chapter 5. He says, because if I say what I'm saying, it's not valid. But he says, there is one who speaketh of me, and what he says is true. In verse 8, in chapter 8, he's now telling you what I'm saying is true. He and God were, that we will be there also. Now, when the Bible talks about the spirit of prophecy being the testimony of Jesus, you may not be a prophet, but God has given for all of us to prophesy. The Bible says in Joel 2, it says, in the last days, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. And it says people will prophesy, right? What people are prophesying is the testimony of Jesus. And the testimony of Jesus is the sayings of Jesus before his Father. Our father David said in Psalm 100, he says, my Lord said to my Lord, sit down at my right hand, right? Jesus, God was speaking to Jesus and saying, sit down at my right hand. And David was there. And that is where God is calling each and every one of us to. And you see, in the very last days, we may miss it, because it is not about words. It's not about miracles. Because Jesus was performing miracles, but he was telling them. And you see, it is very important for us to always have the testimony of Jesus. Because that is the accurate word of God concerning us at that particular time. Do you get what I'm saying? Because if you see in different places in the scriptures, I think in John 7, starting from verse 1, Jesus' disciples and his brethren were telling him that he, as the feast is coming up, there are going to be many people there, that he should go up there so that he can do miracles, so that people will believe him. And Jesus said, it is not yet my time. What will have been the better place or better time for you to perform a miracle so that people will know that truly that you are called to be the Son of God? So at all times, we must be in God's will. It is not only important for you to be in God's will, but for you to have wisdom and spiritual understanding concerning God's will for your life. Jesus Christ was sent to come and die on the cross for us. But he sought God's face daily to be able to know what he was meant to do at each time. Because Satan put traps along the way. Was it the time where Peter said, no, God forbid, this will not happen. And Jesus said, get thee behind me, Satan. And that is why you must be careful to who you go to when God has given you a word. Because people can be moved with emotions. People can be moved with the atmosphere and say things. But those things are not from God. And then you take those things and you run with them and you jettison your destiny. Jesus was always careful. There was a time they said after he fed the 5,000 men, he said they were purposed in their hearts to come and take him by force and make him as king. You know what Jesus did? He went away. When you look further down in John 6, after he ran away from them, that was when he now started telling them some hard truths. You know, I put up something on my social, my status message one, and people were laughing and asking. I said, look, if we were in the days of the Pharisees, many of us would be worse than the Pharisees. You know, because now we have NLT, we have Amplified, we have Concordance, we have people who break down the word for you and explain to you what things mean. The way the Spirit of God moves people, and they are able to dissect the word of God and bring you understanding. And we are able to appreciate those things. But in those days, you can imagine in John 6, towards the end, I think from verse 55 down, where Jesus said that you must eat my flesh. He was telling them literally, you must eat my flesh and drink my blood. If a man of God comes in this present time, you know, when we see on social media and we see they are telling people to take soap and wash their mouths. Literally, in those days, Jesus was telling them, you need to eat. He didn't speak in tongues. He spoke in Aramaic, and it was translated as, you must eat my flesh and drink my blood. But it was only those who had the Spirit of God that were able to understand. And guess what? The Pharisees of those days were the movers and shakers of their time. They were the ones that had the gospel. They were the ones that used to teach, like I'm teaching now. They had disciples. So, you know, then they'll say synagogue, but they had people that they used to call rabbis, and each rabbi had their own students. So it was like, you have a rabbi, you have your own this thing, and the rabbi would teach them, just like we teach, right? So you can imagine Jesus now, a rabbi, telling people that you must eat this thing. If it was in this time, they'll say, ah, that's a fake prophet. Do you know that? But we are in a very time that some of us are on the edge of losing out on what God is doing in this season. And why? Because we are not standing with the one who gives a testimony that is true. And it is important. And like I said, Satan knows how to set traps. You know how he sets traps? He puts you around people who will convince you otherwise. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because if we truly believe the word of God, you see, the Bible says that Abraham believed and it was counted unto him as righteousness. That believing meant that he did not do anything else but wait upon God's word. The only time that he strayed away from God's word, what happened? He slept with Hagar, and that's the reason why we have Boko Haram. But along the line, Abraham always hooked on to God's word. And the Bible says it was counted unto him as righteousness. You see, and we must come to a point in time where we believe on God's word holistically. And when I say believing on God's word, it's not the letter. Because that is why the Bible says the letter killeth. You know why? Because these things on the last day will stand against you. Because you heard the word, but it profited nothing for you. Where the Bible says, lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him. He will make your path straight. He says the hearts of kings are in his hands, and he turneth them whichever way he willeth. And that is the hard truth some of us struggle and grapple with. That if you are going to the embassy, why do you need to falsify your account? That if God says, this is what is going to happen to you, why do you need to do things to help God? The Bible says in John 5 verse 25, it says that those that are dead that hear the word of God, they come alive and believe the word of God. So does it mean that those who do not believe, who do not hear and believe the word of God are actually dead men walking? What is the testimony of Jesus? Why we are saying now the testimony of Jesus? Because Jesus has gone where? He has gone to the Father. And he's seated at the right hand of the Father. So he says the testimony of Jesus. When we say prophecy, is of things to come. So when we sit down in the place where God is and Jesus are, and we are having conversations and we are hearing things that come. That is why when somebody gives a prophetic word to you, it resonates with something that you have heard. And prophecies will never come to pass until you hear those prophecies yourself. Until you know those prophecies for yourself. So somebody can come here and tell you things. This is going to happen. This is going to happen. And you have not heard it. Those things will still be hanging. Just like when Pastor was preaching and talking about Nebuchadnezzar. There were words that were spoken over Nebuchadnezzar and they were hanging. But Nebuchadnezzar had to say some things here on earth so that those words would connect with the prophecy that are hanging, and they came down. And those things that you say are the testimony of Jesus. And that is why the Bible says on the last day, they will say that we cast out demons in your name. We did this. And he said, depart from me, I know you not. Jesus Christ was performing miracles. Yet, he said in John 5, he said, the testimony that I will give is not valid. He said, there is one who gives testimony. He will now fast forward to chapter 8. And he now said, this thing that I'm telling you is true. And he gave a reason why. He says, because there are two who bear the same testimony. Myself and the God who sent me. Who sends you? Whose voice are you listening to? You know, sometimes a lot of us do things, and we do things out of how we feel, what we think is right. But there's actually a testimony of Jesus. There's actually a testimony. There are actual words that are coming out of the mouth of Jesus concerning you that you need to hold on to for your breakthrough. What has God spoken to you about the work that you are doing in church? What has God spoken to you about your family, about your children? If you have no words, you are a dead man. If you have, and you see, when the Bible says the Spirit is life, It is because it's the Spirit that quickens the words of Jesus. It's the Spirit that quickens the words of Jesus. Let's go to 1 John 5. 1 John 5. Go to verse 7. It says, for there are three that bear record in heaven. And what does it say? The Father. Who is the Word? But it used another name for Jesus here. The Word. And who? Jesus said it's expedient for I to go so that the Comforter will come. He says, when the Spirit of God comes, he will guide you into all truth. You see, I've purposed in my heart, and it's a prayer that I've been praying in recent times, and that's in Colossians 1, verse 9 and 10. It is not enough to know God's will. It is not enough. Colossians 1, verse 9 to 10. Paul was saying, when he was writing to the church in Colossae, and he said that after we heard of all that concerning you, he says, we pray that you will be filled with the knowledge of God. And with the knowledge, all wisdom and spiritual understanding. So you can know the will of God. But if you do not have wisdom, you jettison the work of God in your life. If you do not have spiritual understanding, you will jettison the work of God in your hands. And that is why the wisdom that we know here and the spiritual understanding comes from the mouth of Jesus. The Bible says in Romans 10 verse 17, it says, faith comes from by hearing, yes? And hearing by the word of God. That word of God is not letter. It's not Bible. It's not this thing that you're hearing. It's not the sermons that you hear. Those sermons that you hear are part of the ingredients and part of the things that activate you to a place where you hear the words of Jesus. Because it says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. That word there is written in capital, and that is, it says, the Hebrew word is, I've forgotten that word, but it is translated as the word of Jesus. Diva Hak Mishayak. That is the word of the Messiah. That is the word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And see, I've come to this understanding, and I don't deceive myself anymore. It is not just enough to read God's word and hear sermons and scriptures and be able to finish what somebody is saying. What is God saying to you? Can you categorically come out and say, this is what God said? And you see, the truth is that Satan will put you in bondage. That, hey, let me not say this. Let it not be as if. Because maybe you think you'll be in a trance and God will say, chike, chike, my son. Listen, that God does not speak that way all the time. And in relationship with God, you develop hearing from God. You develop knowing what God is saying. I tell people, if I'm staying here now and I hear Caris shouting outside, I will know it's Caris. There are a lot of people that may not know. I was in church one day, we were praying. Savior was in front and ENA was crying at the back. It was only Savior that looked back because he was the one that he knew his daughter's voice. So if you do not know the voice of God, how then will you hear what he's saying to you? You know, I started doing something. Intermittently, I'll get words of wisdom, and then it will now be very, very, very bold statements, and people will confer and all that. So sometimes, when something is not looking like what I think it should be, sometimes I want to be quiet and all. But I've learned that as God drops it in my spirit, I speak. On Sunday, I was going home and I was using an Uber. And what just came to me was, I saw the Uber driver, in my mind, I saw a woman coming to him. So I started talking to him about marriage. And I started asking him, I said, are you married? He said, no. I said, do you have somebody that you live with? He said, no. I said, okay, do you have people who come to your house? So he kept quiet. So I now just started talking to him through, I started taking him through marriage, the sanctity of the marriage bed and all that. So when we finished, I now started talking to him how we must abstain from the bed of fornication and all that. And when I finished, we were about getting somewhere, and he quickly asked me, he said, how can he be able to stay away from women? He says, because he was telling me that even sometimes he doesn't go to meet them. They come to meet him. So how can he stay away from? But if maybe when I asked him, oh, are you married? And he said, no. And he said this, and I just stopped there. It will now be like maybe it was wrong. But yes, sometimes you might get it wrong, but it is only in practice that you would know when God is speaking to you. Now, it is important in these final days that we are, that we do not deviate from God's truth. Because Satan of before is still the same Satan now, and is doing more and more things to try and pull the children of God away. They wanted to make Jesus king. The same people who now eventually wanted to kill him. So on which divide will you now be if you function by what people say? If you function by how people's face will be towards you when you do a particular thing. We must in this season shy away from those kind of things. You know, and that's why probably when I started today, that thing of finances came to me. Because I found out that 90% of what a lot of us struggle with are tied towards finances. If you most of the times when people drop prayer requests in offering bag, it has something to do with finances, for school, for this, for that, for this. And if you have a bit of understanding on what it is to be able to steward God's finances, and you are keeping it to yourself, then you are doing a disservice to the body of God. Because it is in the testimonies of God, the testimonies of Jesus, that the breakthroughs happen. You see, sometimes we believe some things will come from a certain place. But God is looking at something entirely different. And when we do not understand or hear the voice of God, we remain moribund. We remain in one place. It's like, you know, there's something that they call the hamster's wheel. Is a wheel that turns around and it has steps. So the hamsters, because they have weight and all that, sometimes they put it inside their cage. So it gives them activity, like you're on a treadmill. You are running, but you are still on the same spot. That's what happens to people who only live on the letter. You know what the letter does? You get inspired when you come to church. When somebody gives a revelation from the back, you shout, Jesus! And that's where it ends. Because it's just letter. There is no place of intimacy for you to understand and know God's voice. So if I call you now and I tell you what is God's plan for your life for the next 5 years, a lot of us will be blank. The things that will be telling you are things that you've seen. Oh, Pastor Chike talked about UI UX, so I'm going to do UI UX. Pastor Chike said this is the new way people are making money, so this is how I'm going to make money. No. What is God saying to you? The Bible says that Isaac sowed in a land. And he said in that land there was famine. Nothing was happening. There was drought. And the Bible says he reaped 100-fold. Now, I can't remember how that explanation is. But 100-fold is not 100 times. 100-fold is not, it is exponential increase. It is not multiplication. So it's more like 100 times 100. It was not just times 100. And this was a place where there was famine because he heard God's voice. Now, my question to you is, what are you hearing? what is being ministered to you. You see, when I saw this scripture, it came out so glaring to me. This is Jesus Christ, a man who we are walking to perfection unto, right? And in between two verses, in between two chapters, chapter 5 and chapter 8, and in between chapter 5 and chapter 8, Jesus Christ was doing great miracles, but he was telling you that I cannot give a testimony. Is it me that said it? Please, when you go back, look into the Bible and see that thing was written in red, right? Because it was Jesus that was saying it. He was careful to know and to say that which was God that was saying it. Jesus was actually the King of Kings, right? But every time they would call him and ask him, they would say, "Are you the King of Jews?" He would say, "It's you that is saying it. You say it's from your own mouth." Jesus was never rushed into doing anything. Jesus was never rushed into saying anything. Jesus was never rushed into being in a particular place, because he was comfortable exactly where he was, because where he was where God was at all times. And that is where we need to be. What is God saying to you? What is God saying to you? And you see, nobody can help you in that aspect. Somebody can come and lay hands on you. Somebody, like Pastor said, lay legs on you. But the Bible says that everything that pertains to life and godliness is where? Bible scholars, or are we too cold? Jesus Christ, the Bible says that he has given unto who? You. Everything that pertains to life and godliness. He didn't say he gave it to somebody else. He didn't say it's in the hand of somebody else. He says everything that you need, godliness, life. Life is these things that we are chasing after. This money, car, marriage, children, success in business, career, that's life. And godliness, things that pertain to spirituality. It says everything is on the inside of you. Everything. It says he has given unto us everything that pertains to life and godliness. So we are the ones that are supposed to unearth it. The Bible says that he will do exceedingly more than we can think or imagine. It says what? According to what? The power that is at work within you. It's different from Ephesians 1 that says that the same power that was wrought in Jesus Christ that raised him up from the dead is the same power that he has given to them that believe. There's power, but it is as much power that is working in you that makes things happen. The Bible says, let your light, what? So who is the person that will make that light shine? You. It says, let your light shine. It is you. So the amount of light you let shine through you is how God will walk. Jesus Christ said, you are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, but some of us are behind the hill, so our light can't shine. My prayer is that we will have hearing ears and seeing eyes. Because, you see, it opened my eyes, really, because I've been studying the New Testament. And the Pharisees, they all read the book of the prophets. And every single thing that was prophesied about Jesus and what he would do, they were all in the book of Isaiah. Everything was there. And, you see, they were even better than us because they knew it word for word. They used to memorize it. But Jesus Christ came in flesh and was standing before them, yet they missed it. Not only missing it, they crucified him. They crucified him. He was right there in front of him. And that's why in Isaiah 42, he said, "Who is blind but my servant? Seeing things, having eyes, yet not seeing things, having ears, but not hearing things." My prayer is that our eyes and our ears will be open. And the only way that it can be open is by an intimate relationship with God. What is God saying to you? Because what God is saying to you will matter more than anything on the day of your breakthrough. That God will tell you to do something. Your flesh, that's why you see flesh, we need to subdue it. You need to subdue flesh. Because when you subdue flesh, that is when things break out. People get their testimonies because they are able to release things. God will tell you, that car, in rounding up, there's a testimony that Pastor Adeboye gave. He said God told a particular man that he should sow a Mercedes Benz, and he refused to sow that Mercedes Benz to Pastor Adeboye. He said after he refused to sow that seed as that car as a seed, after he was driving that car, after like 2 or 3 months, he had accidents, he had this, then he quickly ran and came and said, give him. And Pastor Adeboye knew that God told him. He said, well, the time has passed that he should just go before God and ask for forgiveness. But guess what? After the time he was supposed to give the car had broken down. The car had, he had had accidents and this thing. So my point is, there are things that a word of obedience would change for you. That 7 hours of prayer or rolling on the floor, crying, sowing of seeds, a word of obedience can change all those things. What word are you listening? And you know why I'm saying, I particularly use these examples. Because sometimes somebody might say, oh, it's time to sow a seed and all that. Yes, you come out and you sow a seed and you're pinning it on something. But God may have spoken to you in the past concerning something else for what you are believing for. And then when things don't happen, it will now be like God is a liar. I've had people that sowed seeds and then they'll come and say, this thing is not working, this thing is not working. God is not a jukebox that you put in money and you say, play this music for me. That's not how it works. Because sometimes some of us sow seeds not out of love of God, but out of greed and necessity. This is what I'm believing God for. Let me sow seed because I need this. Meanwhile, sometimes your breakthrough is tied to a word of obedience that God will give you at a time when you are not even praying, nobody's calling for seed. God will just tell you, that person, maybe the person that you don't even like, or somebody that you'll be like, but this one has more than me now. Why is God telling me to do this thing for this person? Or God is saying, this thing that this person did to you, just forgive him. In fact, go and meet the person and say it's okay. Some of us can say, okay, God, I've forgiven him. I'll just mind my business and go. But God may be telling you, go and meet that person and discuss with that person. Let me break it down for that. God can even tell you, go and apologize to the person. See, Christianity is easy, but it's also hard. Because it will draw at your flesh. You see that flesh. You see that pride. You know, I've come to sometimes I stand in front of the mirror and I tell myself the truth. I know the places where I'm failing. It's not that I'm coming and I'm pretending to you. And when you become honest with yourself, half of your problem is solved. When you know that you are a proud person, when you know that you are a rebellious person, when you know that you are a carefree person, the things that God is dealing with, and you find out that it is in the place of that thing that your breakthrough is tied. Because God wants to break that thing for your breakthrough to come. Let's stand up. We're in a time and season where we is no longer playing church. Because we are coming to a season where there's going to be a clear separation of those who are truly following God and those who are not. So I want you to pray a simple prayer this evening. And The simple prayer is that, God, I want a seeing eye and a hearing ear. It's a simple prayer. A seeing eye. What did I say? A seeing eye and a hearing ear. You know why? Because the very thing that you think you are looking for is right in front of you, but it's like you are running around in circles and those things are going. So just open your mouth and pray. It's a simple prayer. A seeing eye and a hearing ear. That God break down things, resistances. That you are able to let things go. People will hurt you in the office. People will say things against you. But God will tell you to pray for that person. God will tell you when that person is sick. God will tell you you should be the one that should go and be visiting that person every day. God will tell you that very thing that you hold dear to you. Give it to somebody that does not deserve it. He will break you. And the reason of that breaking is that, just like Jesus said, when Satan comes, you say the prince of this world comes, but he has nothing in me. There's nothing Satan can hold on to. That God is willing to put 100 million in your bank account, because if he says tomorrow that he wants 80 or 90 million out of it, you will give it. Then you begin to see the true riches of God. Or you have 5,000 naira and you can't let go of 500 and you are asking God for 5 million. It doesn't work that way. You must hear God. You must hear what Jesus is saying. You must hear what the Messiah is saying concerning you. A hearing ear and a seeing eye. That's what we ask of you, Lord. That is what we ask of you, Lord. Father, we thank you. Thank you for your word, O Lord. Thank you, Father, Lord, for the testimony of Jesus. Thank you for the spirit of prophecy. Father, we ask that you give us seeing eyes and hearing ears, that we will not miss out on what you are doing in this season, that by our own hands we will not jettison our destinies. That, Father, Lord, we ask for strength in our areas of weaknesses. Father, Lord, you know where we are weak. Some of us, we are envious. Some of us, we are impatient. Some of us, we are not patient enough to wait for God. Father, we ask for your help. We ask that the Spirit of God will help us. Where we are weak, O Lord, that you will help us. That we will break the yoke of Satan in our lives. We will break the bonds of slavery in our lives. And Father, Lord, we will come out victorious. We will come out victorious. Thank you for your word. Thank you because we are light. And Father, Lord, we will not be hidden behind the hill. We will be set upon the hill that we may give light, and the world shall come unto our brightness. Father, Lord, we give you all the glory, for we've prayed in Jesus' most precious name.
Let the church
say.